What's going on, everybody? It's Jay Wilson, and we are here at the Aquatic Experience 2017. But I want to bring you something different. I don't want to bring you, hey, check out the new vendor. I want you to see something that you need to see. I want you to hear things that you need to understand, not just to repeat. I'm here with Bob from PJAC. Bob, what do you do for PJAC?
I'm the Vice President of Government Affairs, so I do a little bit of everything for PJAC, to include staffing and being the staff lead for our aquatics issues.
Okay. So, folks, you may have heard that there's some issues going on with Hawaii. And some people will say, well, it doesn't affect me. It doesn't, it's none of my concern. And then you speculate about what you hear. But Bob's going to give us a little bit of lowdown so we can understand what's really going on. And then you can make a decision on if you really want to help impact for the better or continue allowing it to go down a path that you don't want to see in 10 years. So, Bob, tell us a little bit about what's going on in Hawaii.
All right, yeah, absolutely. In fact, let me start with just a little bit of history on
it.
Every year or every legislative session in Hawaii, we'd see very similar bills, four or five or six of them, usually targeting different ways to try and put the aquarium trade out of business. We've seen everything from what they tried last year again, which was eliminating fishing licenses, to we've literally seen bills that would have made it illegal to sell aquarium fish, or for that matter, to have an aquarium unless you went out diving, caught the fish yourself, and took it home to your tank in Hawaii. So a little bit of everything from the activists. And what was different this year was that one of the bills that would have phased out all fishing licenses over about 5 years suddenly got traction. And we really think it was largely a result of the fact that legislators are just tired of having these people beat on their doors, and they wanted to see something pass, and there was a real concerted effort to misrepresent the science in Hawaii, which, fortunately for us, is really substantial. We ended up having to jump in at the last minute and, frankly, spend a whole lot of money. We managed to get somebody who really understood the fishery in Hawaii to represent us, and he did a lot on our behalf. But we also really saw a big effort by the scientific community to stand up and say that what the activists are saying was not true, and that Hawaii is arguably the best managed and fishery in the world that has probably the best data to work off of.
So I would actually agree with that for one reason. I lived in Hawaii for 8+ years. And there's a very big touristy place called Hanama Bay. It's a very big snorkeling reef area. And the reef was degrading slightly. And so Hawaii wanted to figure out how to keep these things natural without... humans, we ruin things. I mean, that's what we do. But there's some great people out there that do great work. So you had to watch a 30-minute video before you can go snorkeling at this place as a tourist. And then you never had to watch it again. So Hawaii does do a wonderful job trying to protect its natural habitats and its species, that when you get these activists, and no offense to activists out there, because you guys are very passionate, and I'm very proud of that. But what I'm not proud about is the speculative numbers just to push an agenda. It's just not fair to everybody. And so if we continue to just say it didn't matter to us because I keep African cichlids and banning fish from Hawaii is okay, what do you see in 5 years?
Well, and you're exactly right. That's the trickle down, or the camel's nose under the tent, is what this really is. Because if they find that they can use bad data and a lot of emotion in order to convince people to shut down such a fantastically managed fishery, then they can do it anywhere. You know, a lot of our freshwater fish are aquacultured, and that hasn't been targeted yet, but the day will come, because the folks that we find that are most passionate about this fighting us, I've heard them describe their effort as being based on the fact that they don't believe that fish should have to live in glass prisons. And when you're dealing with a mentality like that, it's very difficult to have a fact-based argument, a fact-based discussion.
That makes sense. So I keep African cichlid, as you folks watching know. Imagine in 10 years or 5 years or tomorrow, they completely banned any export of any wild-caught fish from Lake Malawi, Lake Tanganyika, the Victorian Basin. Does it affect you now? Are you understanding that it does? Just because it starts with salt and it doesn't affect you, doesn't mean it's not ever going to affect you. And folks at PJAC are doing a phenomenal job helping us as fellow hobbyists keep the fish we love and to continue doing the things we love professionally and managed properly. Don't get crazy, but professional and managed properly. Folks, you need to understand this stuff. If you don't know, you should research. Everything will be in the description on everything you need. Do you think, one last question, Bob, do you think we're going to see any win with Hawaii right now?
Honestly, I do. In the short term, it's going to be a challenge. We've actually asked and been included into the court case. We've even joined on the behalf of the fishermen and on the side of the state of Hawaii in pursuing this case. We are hopeful that we can get the current ban on the licenses lifted, so that fishermen can continue to fish as this is going through the process. Because ultimately, what it's going to take to resolve this is a document that meets the Environmental Protection Act requirements for Hawaii. So we're trying to get the fishermen back to work while we help to prepare that document and help fund preparation of that document. But that could be up to a year-long process. And your point is exactly right with regard to the freshwater fish. I spent a lot of time this morning actually again talking to the Project Piaba folks. So the effect on freshwater fish, targeting live catch not only can affect freshwater fish, but it can have a substantial impact on the larger environment as well.
Absolutely.
One of the huge things Project Piaba does is communities have found that by sustainably fishing for freshwater fish, they've found that protecting their environment means not clear-cutting the rainforest like is happening in so many other places. So now you've got freshwater fish not only being sustainably harvested, they're providing economic benefit to folks who otherwise would be moving to the city and living in the slums, and keeping the community from being clear-cut. So there are huge upsides to protecting live capture of fish. Which is not to say that we don't also believe that aquaculture has a place too. There is a place for both, and it's finding that reasonable and rational balance that's important.
So I'll touch one last time. First of all, Bob, thank you so much for taking the time to sit down with me. Bob just said one thing that I think you missed. He said that there are folks living in, whether it's freshwater, saltwater, that need jobs as well. And if their jobs is to do this professionally, and we're not overdoing it, we're doing it properly, we won't have these issues of we don't have enough jobs. We're pushing physically people out of jobs. We're pushing people out of villages in the Amazon, in Africa. We're pushing people away. Fishermen don't have anything, any money to pay for their family anymore because of some activists that think that we're going to wipe out a whole species of something. Not saying that can't happen, but if we're professional and mindful of what we're doing, we should be okay. Thank you so much for what you do. I really appreciate it.
Hey, thank you, Jay.
You know what's next.